This engine is better in every way than a conventional reciprocating piston engine. It's more efficient, it makes more power, and it even has much better engine balance. First up, the efficiency. Now, in a conventional engine, when combustion occurs, the rod is at an angle. Of the four strokes, the combustion stroke is the stroke which creates by far the highest load on the engine. And it transfers this load vertically through the vertically moving piston onto an angled connecting rod. So this load is actually trying to flip the rod over. As the rod tries to do this, it ends up pushing the piston harder into the cylinder wall, and this reduces efficiency. It reduces efficiency because it increases friction, and friction is wasted energy because less of the energy created by combustion now gets to be turned into useful work. A part of it is wasted on friction. The other problem this creates is that it creates uneven wear in the engine cylinders. Because of this, one side of the cylinder always wears more than the other over a period of many, many miles. Now, we can sort of fix this in a conventional design by offsetting the cylinder center from the crankshaft center. This does improve efficiency because it reduces the rod angle, but it's a compromise and only a partial solution. It's a compromise because it complicates engine balance, it makes it harder to fix, and it's only a partial solution because a large chunk of the friction still remains. But in our unconventional engine, this problem is almost non-existent because the rod is never at an angle. And now the vertical load of the combustion transferred to the vertically moving piston is also vertically transferred onto the rod, which is also always moving vertically. The effect of trying to flip the rod over is much less pronounced, and therefore friction is greatly reduced. We can do this because we have now incorporated the entire side-to-side horizontal range of motion of the big end of the rod into the big end itself, which means that the rod never has to assume any angle. Now, the great thing about this is that because both the rod and the piston are now moving vertically in the same way, we can make them as one single part. We can get rid of the wrist pin, which means that we get rid of the friction between the piston and the wrist pin and the rod. And this further improves efficiency. It also improves strength and reliability because we're reducing the number of moving parts. Next up, power. Now we have to ask ourselves, how does a different rotating assembly anatomy even increase power? Well, it does this by buying more time for the engine to harness the energy of combustion. This even increases efficiency at high RPM, where the window for harnessing combustion energy becomes increasingly smaller. So now we have to ask ourselves, how does a different rotating assembly anatomy increase the time for harnessing combustion energy? It does this by not pulling the piston down faster than necessary. Now, as you can plainly see in our conventional engine, the connecting rod transitions from fully upright to fully angled when we rotate from 0 to 90 degrees. This means that the rod is effectively becoming shorter in relation to the piston and the crankshaft. By becoming shorter, it pulls down the piston by an additional little distance. And this distance equals the difference in height or length between the rod fully upright and the rod fully angled. And here, if you watch closely, you can clearly observe how the rod angling interferes with the piston motion. It creates an additional little acceleration which pulls down the piston faster from top dead center. Now, in our unconventional engine, as you have seen, the connecting rod never angles. It's always fully vertical, which means that it doesn't pull down the piston any faster. In other words, it increases piston dwell time in the area around top dead center. And this is the area where peak combustion pressure builds. By keeping the piston longer here, we allow more energy of the combustion to be transferred onto the piston and turned into useful work. And finally, the balance. Why is the balance better in the unconventional engine? Again, it's because of the rod. It's always the rod. In the conventional engine, as we have seen, the angling of the rod pulls down the piston by an additional distance. The piston covers this distance with a changing speed or acceleration. This happens because piston speed is always changing during engine operation. And obviously, the piston also has a certain mass. So if we have acceleration and mass, this tells us that the angling of the rod creates a certain force. This force is known as a secondary force. It creates imbalances known as secondary imbalances, which cause problems for the engine because they increase engine vibrations. All conventional engine designs are subject to these vibrations, and the only way to get rid of them is to rely on opposite secondary forces from other cylinders if they're present, or to use balancing shafts to get rid of these vibrations. But as you have seen, in our unconventional engine design, the rod is always fully vertical. It's never angling, which means that we achieve something that a conventional design never could, and that is the complete elimination of secondary vibrations even in single cylinder form, leading to a smoother running engine in almost all relevant cylinder configurations. Now, our unconventional engine has a name, and it's called a Scotch Yoke engine. A Scotch yoke is simply an alternative way of converting rotation into reciprocation. And this design is not new at all. It was employed many times in the past on steam engines, on hot air engines, as well as by a man called Russell Bourke, who in the 20s experimented with the Scotch yoke design, and he wanted to use it to improve existing two-stroke engines at the time. He even made several working prototypes, but his design was never commercialized. And this now brings us to the elephant in the room. If the Scotch yoke design is so much better than a conventional design, then why do all of our vehicles, land, sea, and air, use a conventional rotating assembly instead of a Scotch yoke one? Well, this is because the Scotch yoke creates two inherent problems for the engine. And the culprit behind these two problems is, you guessed it, it's the rod. I told you, it's always the rod. The first problem the rod creates is weakness. The second problem the rod creates is very complicated friction. The weakness is honestly pretty obvious if you just take a look at the rod. And as you can see, especially at the bottom, this long, thin section, it's pretty obvious how even small loads could buckle or deform this thin, little weak part of the rod. Number two, the sliding block in the rod that is sliding across the slot in the rod is relying on sliding friction to keep working. It's creating sliding friction, actually, and sliding friction by itself is not very desirable because it can be complicated inside an engine and it can cause many issues. We really want to avoid sliding friction when possible. Now, sliding friction by itself would be an issue that could be resolved if it wasn't further made problematic by the fact that we're applying large combustion loads onto the sliding friction, onto the block. We're trying to push it into the surface as it's trying to slide through its range of motion. This is the issue that rendered many prototypes, in fact, all prototypes of early Scotch yoke engines useless because it caused very rapid wear and engine failure. And if we go back to the conventional design, we can see how, number one, there is no sliding friction anywhere. Everything is round and it's just sort of revolving around each other. Nothing is sliding on anything. And also the rod, if we observe the rod, we have a uniform circular design, which is obviously much stronger than the long, thin slot of the Scotch yoke rod. However, Scotch yoke rod. However, advancements in engineering, material science, and manufacturing and machining are now promising to make it possible to resolve the inherent issues of the Scotch yoke design and to make it commercially viable. We have things now like very, very, very accurate machining, composite materials, as well as other important advancements that might make the Scotch yoke possible in modern times. And this brings us to Alfadan. As some of you may know, 2 years ago, I made a video about a company that is trying to bring a novel engine design to market. This company is called Alfadan, and according to their patent, what they're trying to bring to the market is a Scotch yoke inline 4 engine. Now, the video that I made got really popular for some reason, and I got many questions, and I still get many questions asking for updates. I also get a lot of accusations that I promoted a scam. So today, since we're speaking about Scotch yoke engines, I'd love to offer some answers to both past, current, and future questions. So let's get started. Number one, I am not an employee or representative of Alfadan. As such, I cannot give any updates on what is happening with the engine. The only thing I know is what Alfadan releases to the public. if they choose to tell me something that is not yet public, then I will happily share it on this channel. So again, not an employee, not a representative. I simply made a video to share something, a technology which I found interesting and exciting. And I still think that a engine that gets rid of secondary imbalance has potentially large implications for the market as a whole. Number two, Alfadan is not a scam. I have not promoted anything or told anyone to invest in anything. And even if I did, I have not promoted a scam. The people who are saying that Alfadan is a scam seem to lack the very basic understanding of how investment and finance works. So, some concrete scenarios for you. Let's imagine you go out and you buy stocks of a certain company. That company declares bankruptcy tomorrow, the day after you buy the stocks. Your stocks are now worth next to nothing. Have you been scammed? The answer is no. A more concrete example, let's say you spend a lot of money and you invest into an apartment complex, a real estate investment. A flood comes, you're not insured, and your entire apartment complex is now destroyed. Have you been scammed? No. This is because all investments carry an inherent risk. It is impossible to have an investment without some risk. This is true for stocks, options, crowdfunding things, real estate, you name it. There is no investment without risk. And a further reason why Alfadan is not a scam is if you go to their crowdfunding page and attempt to invest in Alfadan, you get a very big, very obvious message telling you the following. And it says, this Reg A Plus offering is made available through Start Engine Primary LLC. This investment is speculative, illiquid, and involves a high degree of risk, including the possible loss of your entire investment. So, even if you're completely inexperienced and know nothing about finance or investments, you are told that you may lose everything. A scam involves some sort of fraudulent information, some attempt at deception. I buy a car, the car has 200,000 miles on the clock. I fiddle with the odometer to make it display 100,000 miles. And then I sell this car to you as a car with 100,000 miles on it. That is a scam because I am trying to deceive you. Investment is not a scam because nobody is trying to deceive you of anything. It's up to you to decide what you believe in and where you want to invest. And you are being told that there is an inherent risk to all types of investments. Therefore, Alfadan, many other crowdfunding schemes, stocks, you name it, it's not a scam. Now, what I do know about Alfadan is that the project is alive despite a lack of public updates. I know this because I spoke with the CEO personally some 2 months ago. They wanted to hire me to do some 3D animations for them. In the end, we didn't come to an agreement, but we did speak briefly about the engine, and I was told they are actively and continuously working on developing the engine. They seem to be planning to use novel composite materials to resolve some of the inherent issues of the Scotch Yoke. They seem to be aiming to release something in the near future, which seems to be 2024. Of course, whether that will happen, only time will tell. But again, the project is alive despite a lack of public updates. Now, speaking of public updates, in hindsight, looking at it now, in the past 2 years, I personally feel like the crowdfunding attempt from Alfadan might have been a mistake. It drew a lot of attention to the company at a time where there wasn't much to show. And of course, many people don't really, understandably, they don't understand the complexities involved in developing a novel engine design. This is a very lengthy, complex, and expensive process that can require millions upon millions of dollars, and it can even easily spiral out of control to require further millions beyond the initially expected millions. On the other hand, people, of course, expect frequent updates, and if the updates aren't there, it all looks a bit awkward. On the other hand, the design, the development process the updates might even look, you know, very silly, because sometimes you spend years doing the same thing. So you might have updates like 10 times in a row, the same thing. We're working on the thingamajig, and it could be always the same thingamajig. So, you know, it's not very simple. It's a big thing to put into a crowdfunding, you know, scheme. And to put it into perspective, even a company like Koenigsegg is taking more than 8 years to put on the market a novel way of opening and closing a valve, you know, compared to an entire novel rotating assembly. Even a company like Mazda struggled to put out the rotary engine on the market to make it reliable and usable. So to expect a novice, tiny little company like Alfadan, who is basically subcontracting Mahle, to get something on the market in a very short time frame would be overly optimistic and unrealistic. That being said, I do feel like Alfadan, in the course of the 2 years, has been a bit overly secretive. Initially, I sort of found this relatable because they justified this by feeling how patents aren't sufficient to protect them from larger players in the field who could basically steal and repackage their technology as their own. However, in the course of 2 years, I'm certain that there has been many opportunities to offer public updates without really revealing anything about the technology. You can be vague about the technology, but still give people some insight into what is happening in the development process. They sort of initiated the crowdfunding route, being very open and public, but then they went completely silent, which I think is hurting their public image. However, this is just my opinion, and there's plenty of companies out there with horrible public images who are very profitable, so we don't necessarily live in a very, you know, logical or meritocratic world. All this being said, I still believe that a Scotch Yoke inline 4 engine has the potential to change the game, and it is very exciting technology. Recently, I got a comment saying how it doesn't make sense that I praised Alfadan but criticized FreeValve. Just to be clear, I never criticized or praised anybody. I simply explained why free valve technology doesn't have a lot of mainstream mass market potential. And that's because it's very complex, very expensive, and it isn't a game changer because it doesn't make anything new possible. I believe that a Scotch Yoke inline 4 can be a game changer because it makes something new possible that was impossible before. And that something is a large displacement inline 4 engine. When it comes to free valve technology, I said multiple times in the video that the technology itself is very interesting and that I find it amazing. I never criticized the technology itself, but of course, knowing that takes watching the video before commenting. Now, if we make a large displacement in 9.4, which was previously traditionally limited to about 3 liters due to secondary balance issues, if we make it 3.5, 4, 5 liters, then this means that inline 4 engines can become the go-to performance choice for many vehicles. They might replace V6, inline 6, or even V8 engines. Of course, from an emotional perspective, that is absolutely horrible, but there's no denying the fact that less cylinders and less moving parts means less friction, less cost, and more efficiency. However, the extent to which the Alfadan engine might be capable of changing the market entirely depends on the way they solve the inherent Scotch Yoke issues. If their solution is something very exotic and very expensive, then they will be limited to the fancy outboard market, just like FreeValve will be likely limited to the very fancy expensive car market. However, if Alfadan comes up with something that is relatively simple and not cost prohibitive, then they have the potential to venture beyond fancy outboards and impact and change a much larger market.